Nice to be here. I'm excited about this topic. My co-author, Marissa, was not able to be here. She's finishing up her degree in color science and has also begun a program at the Eastman House in video and film conservation. So we're very excited to have color scientist entering into the conservation field for imaging. And this work was done while I was on sabbatical at the Getty Conservation Institute in Los Angeles. And so the motivation came about. They have a fairly large research program that's developed by Jim Drusick, shown on the bottom with a filter in front of his face. And the idea here was to be designing filters to put in front of tungsten illumination that will then be cutting down on ultraviolet emission, as well as to enhance color perception. So there's kind of a big idea of risk assessment when you're trying to develop lighting that will maintain the appearance but is going to minimize damage. And as we know, lighting affects perceived color. This is a rendering of Van Gogh's Starry Night under D65 on the left and incandescent on the right. And I think you can see that the differences in color appearance are certainly visible. And of course, we imagine that changes in lighting will affect perceived color. One of the pigments that he's worked with a lot is cobalt blue, and that's shown on the bottom. And one of the common features of cobalt blue is that its appearance under tungsten or incandescent lighting tends to be much more reddish. Now, commonly in the lighting industry and in museums, the main metric for lighting quality is color rendering index. And these are the 8 samples that are forming the CIE General Color Rendering Index. And of course, this index is not designed to look at appearance changes across differences in lighting. In other words, the color and constancy kind of thing. It's really looking at test lights that are trying to reproduce the same color perception as a reference light. And so both of these lights, although the perceptions are quite different, and what I've done on the bottom is to cut out the blue sample so you can see their differences, they both have color rendering indices of 100. So such an index is not very useful for the museum crowd, as well as these colors are fairly low chroma, and so they tend to hide a lot of changes. And problems of the color rendering index are well known. Another issue that plagues museums is digital photography, where you have metamerism in images, often due to retouching. This painting of the tragedy by Picasso is in the National Gallery of Art, and this is a photograph, a scanned photograph from 1980. And during the early 20th century, this is a panel painting, and so some of the paint had fallen off, and the conservator did retouching, so they're filling in missing areas. I don't know how well you can see this, but there are areas here that in this photograph, they reproduce purplish, and it's because of the long wavelength response of ektachrome. This is a classic metameric pair where the conservator had not done any analytical work. And so here we can see that you have the conservator using ultramarine blue, whereas Picasso used Prussian blue. And this is a classic metameric pair. So this difference then is accentuated in the film. And so this is always a problem of conservators when they do photography, wondering whether or not their in-painted areas are going to remain invisible. And so this led me to the research objective, is to design a new target that could be useful for both lighting and imaging research and evaluation. And the tools, or the previous research that I was looking at, was my dissertation research on color constancy. So it only took me about 28 years to be able to have some practical value from it, so, other than getting my PhD, of course. And also work, our friend, the Color Checker, which was originally conceived by Brenneman in the 50s at Kodak, and then refined and then manufactured by Macbeth in the 70s with Cal McCamey. And we've also done work at RIT creating metameric pairs of the color checker. This was work done in collaboration with Iris Sow, who's here, where we were creating metamers of using artist paints, which is very much in the same concept of the work done by Mark Fairchild and Garrett Johnson in creating the Medi-Cal. And there's also been a lot of work recently at NIST in which they're looking at using colors evenly sampled in a hue circle, Munsell colors, in order to develop new metrics for color rendering, as well as work that we had done in the middle 2000s looking at benchmarking museum imaging systems. So the target characteristics that I wanted to achieve were, I wanted real reflectances with the idea that at some point I'm going to make the target. I wanted to use artist pigments so that it could be a better relational target to the museum community. The plan was to create a high chroma hue circle. I wanted to include cobalt blue, known to be problematic. And that color inconstant grays are often very sensitive to differences in camera, in a sense, observer metamerism, as well as metameric pairs. This is the final target that, at least at this stage of development, and here's its appearance under daylight, and then under 2700K incandescent, which is typical of museums, we can see, of course, the color inconstancy, as well as the metameric pairs. So the database was using golden matte acrylic artist paints. And so there's about 50 or so different choices, and these were the pigments that I selected for this. In some ways, I wanted to achieve high chroma colors, and also some of these pigments span some of the spectral properties of many of the other artist materials. So that's the listing. And it, what's kind of going on is, in a sense, we've got a red shade and a green shade of blues, the same of having a green shade and a red shade of yellows, and then moving through the hue circle, adding in magenta and purple. And Kubelka-Munk theory was used to determine the absorption and scattering properties using the mass tone tint method. So in this case, a drawdown is made coming right out of the tube and then mixed with white. And then we could go through the usual Kubelka-Munk equations and then eventually determine an absorption coefficient and a scattering coefficient, and that can then be used in a color mixing formula. And then from that, we can back out reflectance. And so the idea was, having my database of colorants, having my color mixing model, I can then start to formulate a hue circle. And the reference illuminant that was selected for this work was D65 in the 31 Observer, mainly because of D65 being the more familiar illuminant to the museum crowd. I'm not sure in hindsight, and that's one of my questions in a sense, is whether or not that's the best choice of reference illuminant, particularly because of graphic art. So I'm not sure, but this is what I decided to use. And the idea that the optimization was trying to mix two paints pairwise and then maximize their chroma, constraining the concentrations to reality and then moving through the hue circle. And the plan was to use C-Lab and then to sample every 30 degrees, just as a convenience. C-Lab was also selected, again, because of familiarity with the museum community. And then this ends up being the pigments that were selected, and as one might expect, we're sort of moving through the hues, the pigments pairwise. The thing that was interesting to me when I was reviewing this talk was how often a permanent green light ends up being in many of these mixtures. And probably that's somewhat predicated of the way C-Lab defines out hues. Then we took all 2 and 3 pigment combinations to form metameric pairs around L-star of 70 and A-star B-star of 0. My experience has been sort of a higher lightness colors tend to show color inconstancy more effectively. And then from those, four were selected having a range of color and constancy indices, which I'll show later. And you can see that the values are here on the right. And the spectra are certainly different. And one of the things on the bottom is showing the pigment combination. So we've got complementaries with yellow and purple, orange and green. This was mainly black. It had to be tuned in with a little red and yellow because carbon black won't generate a true neutral, and then a three-color gray. And then as far as metamers, I used a different data set, conservation colors, which are used for retouching or in painting. And then we were selecting different low chroma colors, trying to maximize the degree of metamerism. And these are showing the renderings under 2700K. And you can see that the degree of metamerism is pretty good. The pair that I was really fascinated by was this green-brown pair. And those of you from old days of the ISCC will recognize these as being brown wools, which were, I believe, developed by Roland Derby in the 50s or 60s. And so this is the pair that resulted. So I was pretty fascinated that those can be implemented in paint. This was a metameric match to aged lead white, which is often a problem in restoration work because lead white's generally not used, except on the slide. So here's the target, and I have rendered this for also for the 64 observer. I was curious about the sensitivity of the color and constant set. And we can see the color being pretty different here, so the difference between the 31 and 64 observer was certainly showing up in this target. And here is a narrow band fluorescent, which also has different degrees of metamerism, and you can see the color differences depend, of course, on the lighting and the particular pair. As far as metrics, I used a more perceptually uniform space than that achievable by C-Lab, so based on the idea that was done in the 80s by Chaucer, who created a linearization, in a sense, of CMC. And I didn't use the optimized values, but just kept the coefficients similar to delta E2000, again, so it would be easier to teach this to museum users. And then the color and constancy index was comparing a single sample under two different lights. And this is, and I'm weighting lightness and chroma half as important as hue. And one of the key things here, which, as you'll see, becomes problematic, is that I'm using C-Lab as the adaptation transform, again, for the museum crowd. And then the metameric index is the same thing, except pairs of samples are compared. This ends up being the hue circle that was achieved, and I was actually surprised that it came out this circular. It wasn't the objective function. It was just trying to maximize chroma. But it becomes a nice target, which can be used to then evaluate chroma, color contrast, and clarity. And for an example, I had done some research while at Getty in designing white light LEDs that could achieve the similar characteristics to D65. So trying to create a light source with its correlated color temperature equal to D65 and having the same color rendering properties of B65 for artist materials. This was the target used in the optimization, so it's 24 different pigments. And so here's D65, and then I also compared Illuminant A. And so let's look at the lighting results. So this is a nice visualization because it shows how the colors are varying with lighting. So you could potentially measure the volume, you could measure the eccentricity, and so forth. Here's the visualization. And something that I was surprised by, well, I wasn't surprised, but it kind of bummed me out, was that the adaptation transform embedded in C-Lab is really very poor for blue colors. So that these specimens, if you look at them, actually get more red under incandescent, though here we can see that the corresponding calculation in C-Lab made these colors move to the green side. So this is clearly a problem of C-Lab as an adaptation transform. So there it is. As far as looking at the color constant and other pairs, you can see that the LED lighting, although it's very similar in its properties to D65, the metameric pairs are showing some differences. And here I've calculated indices of color and constancy and metamerism for this LED. And so this shows that the concept of using metameric pairs is very, very sensitive at showing very small differences, in this case, lighting. Look at the camera results. So for this example, I used two different cameras, one an RGB. Okay, the 5-1? Okay, good. The RGB area array, and then the other example was using 5 LEDs and a monochrome sensor, which I redid the math to treat it as if it was a 5-channel camera. This is showing the least squares estimates to fitting color matching functions, and just adding sensor channels doesn't necessarily mean that performance is improved in terms of making color matching function type cameras. And these are the results. And so here we can see the RGB camera is having quite a bit of distortion, and the 5-channel is better, but is still distorted. So this is a nice way of showing what's going on. And if we now look at the metameric pairs, the 5-channel camera for these color and constant samples are quite different. The degree of metamerism is also clearly evident. In the proceedings are all the quantitative results. One of the reviewers asked the question, well, how would a color checker do? And the color checker, if we look at its the third row, which is high chroma colors designed to measure color gamut, is also very good at showing these sort of changes in hue. But what the color checker doesn't show are differences, the slight differences, because this grayscale are all made to be spectrally flat. And so the checker is really not as good a visual tool as what I'm proposing. So in conclusion, the target was effective. C-Lab failed. The hue circularity or uniformity is better, but it's not a huge improvement of the color checker. But the concept of the grays and metameric pairs are very useful. And some of the things that I'm now thinking about are the choice of reference illuminant, the number of metameric pairs, perhaps having metamers that are going to be mismatching under different ranges of illuminants, maybe going higher in correlated color temperature. I'm also thinking about re-optimizing the hue circle, and not so much for chroma, but for color and constancy, and then test it out. And finally, we'd like to acknowledge our sponsors, the Getty Conservation Institute and the Mellon Foundation. Thank you.
Questions?
Yes. So
wait for the microphone. Wait for the microphone. The microphone's going to come to you.
Oh, I don't think I need a token. So the first quick question is on the illuminant question. My experience is that almost all we seem to talk about now is being done with ceramic color halide as a, you know, it's a very close to a D50 illuminant.
Yeah.
Probably a primary reproduction illuminant that you definitely want to look at for this problem, because that's sort of the best one we have out there. The other thing is that Solex did a bunch of research on what museum curators liked in terms of actual, you know, what we like to look at these images in, and they also looked at when the artist probably created the map over history. Mm-hmm. And they came up with two lamp sources at 3,800 and 4,200, which seems to be what museums like for actual display of these images. So that those two things on your luminance side, which I think are very interesting. And then my last question is on permanence. So have you looked at the permanence of these particular pigments in the ability to create a target, and a target that will last and be useful in terms of the actual dyes that you're using?
I haven't gone that far with it. I would certainly be looking at the light fastest ratings. One of the things that I've been finding personally is that a lot of modern artist materials have excellent light fastness. I was trying to create a target to evaluate fading. I couldn't find modern pigments that faded sufficiently to show an example. So I think that as long as I'm within the range of high light fastnesses judged by ASTM, I think I'm okay. The issue of the 3800K, I think is debatable because all the psychophysics were done on postcards. And so they were using CMYK images, which only have cyan ink, which doesn't exhibit a lot of the problems of artist material. So that's just an aside. But thanks for your comments.
Roy, very nice talk. You know, thank you very much. I just want to update you a little bit information on the CIE color rendering index. Okay. Currently, by this effort to include invites in optimizing or finding a new set, okay, the new test set, okay. And based on the different principle, one is very similar to yours, very high saturated colors. But we found that all these colors are very highly color inconstant. So you can very easily to fine tune and AT all this way, make it and achieve the target. So this problem that we're going for, not just the very saturated color, but also uniformity. You know, they are very uniform in the taste, and the results by will be much more fair. You know, it's not a compromise that will put in the set of the light source. Okay, but anyway, it's very good.
Oh, good. That's great. If you could get buy-in from the lighting crowd, right? So.
Let's thank our speaker again. You can